so glad you're here. My husband and I just want to say thank you so much for choosing Christian Center as your place of worship. Our service is about to start in just 5 minutes, so if you'd like to grab a cup of coffee, finish checking your kids into See Kids, and head into the sanctuary, we've got a great day of worship planned for you. We'll see you soon.
One time I was waiting for the bus with my son. I remember it was so hot outside and he hadn't had a nap. It seemed like the bus was never going to come. And then this old man walked up. The hat he was wearing stood out to me. I remember that. My son was not giving in, but it didn't seem to bother the man. He looked over at me and said, "Looks like you got a real precious one there." I thanked him and looked down the street, hoping to see the bus coming. Honestly, I was probably just embarrassed by the way my son was acting, but before I knew it, he was off on his way. I couldn't help it. I felt compelled to say it. So I just called after him. "Sir? Sir?" And he turned around. I said, "I just wanted to say thank you for your service." And I'll never forget this moment. He smiled real wide at me like he'd known me my whole life. Gently tipped his hat and said, "You're very welcome. You were worth it."
Amen, church. Yes, yes. Can we give it up for our veterans this morning? Amen. Amen. So who's ready to praise the one who paid the ultimate price? All right, let's stand to our feet this morning. We're just going to pray and just get ready for worship. We're going to prepare our hearts. Is he worthy of our praise this morning? Amen. Let's just lift a hand, both hands. All right, we're just going to pray. Father, we love you so much, and we just thank you for your presence this morning. We thank you, God, that you saw fit to send your son to die for our sins, that we could have relationship with you, that we could come into this place and worship you. And God, I just pray that you would inhabit our praises this morning. That you would be so blessed. Lord, we're not worried about our blessings this morning. We're worried about blessing you this morning. So God, I pray that you would be blessed by our time this morning. That you would accomplish all that you want to accomplish in and through us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs. before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty Fortress, you go before. Before us, nothing can stand against the power of our God. You win it in shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Sing it!
Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty Fortress, you go before.
before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side. How I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. How I fight my battles. This is 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 how I fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. How we fight our battles. This is 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 how we fight our battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how we fight our battles. 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 This is how we fight our battles.
Come on, sing that. Just lift up your hands right now. Amen. I don't know what battle you're going through. I don't know what you are facing, but right now, amen, the Spirit of the Lord is in this place. And I just want you to just sing this again. I'm going to fight not with my words. I'm going to fight not with my mind. I'm going to fight by the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. Oh, this is how I fight. Oh, yes, Lord.
This is how we fight our battles.
You're going to win.
This is how we fight.
You're going to win. Glory to God. Oh,
this is how we fight,
yes, Lord.
Our battles.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Make that declaration.
This is how we fight our battles.
Hallelujah.
This is how we fight our battles.
Hallelujah, Lord.
This is how we fight our battles.
It may look like.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Sing it in faith now.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles.
Glory to God.
This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how we fight our battles.
It may look like I'm surrounded.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Thank you, Lord.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles.
Come on, let me hear you
this
sing
it, church.
This is
how I fight my battles.
Oh, let me hear you
this
sing it, declaration.
This is how I fight my battles.
Oh, yes,
this is
Lord.
How I fight my battles.
Yes,
this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
This is how I fight my battles.
Glory to God.
This is how I fight my battles.
Let me tell you what I feel like I'm supposed to tell you. This is what God told Joshua. He is standing on the bank of the Jordan. He is getting ready to lead God's people into their promise. And this is what the Lord said. He said, have not I commanded you? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid. Be not dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with you wherever you go. How many can receive that right now? Just give God a shout of praise in this place. No matter what you are up against, do not fear. Do not be dismayed. You know why? Because the Lord thy God is with you right now. In Jesus' name, give God a hand clap of praise in this place. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I'm surrounded by you.
Oh, yes, Lord.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded.
Come on, receive that right now. Receive it.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh,
this is how I fight my battles.
victory in Jesus' name.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. How many have the victory today? Let me hear you shout amen. Turn around, tell five people, I've got the victory. Glory to God. Come on, say it with conviction. I've got the victory. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, this is how I fight. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Oh, you're in the presence of Almighty God today. Glory to God, what an honor, what an honor, what an honor to worship Him. Glory to God, hallelujah, praise God. How many are glad to be in the house of God today? Amen. We are so glad to have you here this morning. Presence of the Lord is in this room, and we just want to keep worshiping Him. Amen. Just keep honoring Him, bringing glory to Him. Amen. He's worthy of our praise. We are so glad to have you. Amen. This morning. How many came expecting the Lord to give you what you need in this place today? Amen. Praise God. I want you to have that level of expectation, the desire. Amen. The Lord is going to fulfill that. I know that. Amen. I'm excited to see that. And we're so glad, amen, you are here this morning. We're just going to continue to worship the Lord. But as we do, I want us to pray. I want us to pray for the United States of America today. How many are glad for the freedom that we have in our nation this morning? In spite of everything that is going on in the world around us, we live in a country that is founded upon the principles of the Word of God. And because of that, we are free. And this morning, this weekend is Veterans Day. I don't ever want to take for granted the freedom that my family, that I enjoy. And I know it came because men and women were willing to give of themselves, some paying the ultimate sacrifice to fight for our country. And I believe we need to take a moment right now to honor those within our congregation today that has served the United States of America. And if you are a veteran on any level, I want you to stand right now, right where you are. Come on. If you served in the military, I'd like you to stand right where you are. Come on, you need to give them recognition and honor because of what they have done. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on, stay standing. Stay standing. I want to say thank you. Thank you for what you have done. Thank you for how you have given. And thank you for the service that you have. And we honor you today, all of you. We honor you for what you have done for our country. And I don't believe that God is done with America yet. There is still something happening in the United States of America where God is moving in our country. So I want you, if you will you join these veterans by standing today? And I want us to collectively pray together. And I want us to stand in agreement that the Lord would continue to shine His blessing on the United States of America. I believe that He will. Amen. If we ask in faith. So would you just join me right now and let's pray together. Father, thank you for our nation. Thank you for our country. Thank you for these men and these women, Lord, in our midst that have served so faithfully. Lord, I pray a special blessing on our veterans today. I pray that you would provide for them. I pray, God, that you would meet their every need. You would supply for them. And Father, we just pray your blessing on our country. We pray your blessing on our president, on our Congress, on, Lord, those that are in authority. Holy Spirit, I pray, God, that you would revive the pastors and the churches of our nation, that we would see revival in our country in these last days, a resurgence of the Word of God in America again. And we believe, Lord, for your name to be glorified in our nation. And Father, in conjunction, we pray, Lord, for Israel. We pray, Lord, for the conflict that is in the Middle East, that you would protect your people. And Father, may your will be done. And Lord, we believe that we are, my Lord, your light in this darkened generation. And Father, we thank you for that opportunity. We thank you for that privilege. And Father, we just collectively say, God, bless America. Come on, would you say that out loud with me right now? God, bless America. Come on, say it again. God. And how many believe that he will? Let me hear you shout amen. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, let's sing that together. And I just want you to sing it from your heart. Sing it in faith. God bless America. Glory to God. Let's sing it together now.
Bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home.
All right, everybody join in. Let's sing this together.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above.
From the mountains.
From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my forever all my days. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, one more time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus reigns. Hallelujah, Jesus reigns. Hallelujah, Jesus reigns. Forever all my days. Hallelujah. Forever all my days. Hallelujah. Forever all my days, hallelujah.
We praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Is Jesus reigning in your heart this morning? Is he reigning in your life this morning? Is he your King this morning? Is he your Lord this morning? We're not going to have peace on the outside until we have peace on the inside. Amen? I want to do something real quick here. If you don't know the Lord this morning, I'm going to pray a prayer right now, okay? You need to receive him into your heart this morning for that peace, for that joy that only he can give. So if you don't know the Lord, I want everybody to pray this, but if you don't know the Lord, I want you to do that now, okay? Raise your hands with me. And repeat this after me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I surrender to you. Be the Lord of my life. Forgive me for all of my sins. Heal my heart. Lead me and guide me. Lord, I just give you my life right now. I thank you so much for all that you have done for me. In your name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he? So we're going to have altar workers after service. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to come up here. They want to talk with you, okay? Kind of keep you on the right path. They want to speak to some wisdom into your life to help you step forward. I don't know if anybody prayed that, but we need to do that. Amen. He's our King. He's our Lord. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You may be seated for just a second. My name's Lee Barlow, Executive Pastor here at Christian Center. We just want to welcome you this morning, everyone, but especially the first-time visitors. Let's give it up for them. Thank you for being here. We want to meet you after service. My wife and I will be in the VIP lounge. It's located just across from the Harvest Grind Cafe. There's a card in the pew in front of you. If you would take one of those cards, fill it out, take it back there. We have a gift for you. Answer any questions you might have. Let's give it up for them one more time. Hallelujah. Thank you so much for being here. You're home. This is your home. We want to welcome you and thank you for being here. So a lot is going on here at Christian Center. As we move into the winter time coming up here, I'm sorry to say, but we do have a lot going on. Please turn your attention to the announcement video for all the details.
Good morning, CCC family. Thanks so much for choosing to worship with us this morning. Before we get back into worship, here's a quick look at what's happening here at the church.
On Sunday, November 19th, we'll be hosting our next water baptism service, and we'd be honored if you'd join us. Water baptism is a special celebration of new life in Christ and is your next step after accepting Jesus as your Savior. If you've recently dedicated or rededicated your life to Jesus and would like to join us for baptism, you can sign up at the event registration desk or on the CCC app.
Shalom, travelers. Tickets are now available for the Walk to Bethlehem, our premier event of the Christmas season. Join us as the streets of Bethlehem come alive in the halls of Christian Center, ready for you to explore. You can get tickets by going to events.humanitix.com/WTB2023, searching for Walk Through Bethlehem on Humanitix, or scanning the QR code on the screen. Hope to see you for Walk Through Bethlehem 2023.
On Wednesday, November 15th at 7 p.m., come join us for our annual Fall Pie Social in the Harvest Grind Cafe. Before you take off for your Thanksgiving celebrations, be sure to stop by our family table for a huge celebration of all God has given to us. Everyone is invited to bring a dessert if you'd like, but it's not a requirement. To sign up to bring a dessert, head to the event registration desk or check the CCC app.
That's all for this week. There's a lot happening, so if you need some help keeping up, download our app on the Google Play or Apple App Stores. It has a full list of events, along with sermon recordings, an archive full of service recordings, and even a full Bible with reading plans. You can also check out our website at www.christiancenter.org for even more info. Thanks again for worshiping with us this morning at Christian Center Church, where we're connecting to God and connecting to each other.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, as we continue in worship, how many know that giving to the Lord is imperative? It's a form of worship, isn't it? You know, this is not all there is there? This world. We're supposed to lay up treasures in heaven. Amen? We look forward to what we have. What you do now is going to affect your future forever. Amen? So I'm going to invite the ushers to come up here. We're going to go ahead and take our offering. So if everyone could stand, take your offering in your hand. We would just want to give this to the Lord and expect great things back. Amen? Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for this offering that you've given to us, that we just give back to you. Lord, we pray that it goes forth and it's used how it's supposed to be used. Father God, that it will touch nations as we give. It will be a blessing to those around us, Father God. And I pray for your hand of blessing upon those who give this morning in ways they haven't seen before. Spiritually, financially, in every way, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's give this morning.
Everybody give Jesus just a good hand clap of praise this morning. He's worthy. I said he's worthy. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, it is good to be in the house of God today. Praise God. I am so glad you are here this morning. Welcome to Christian Center. Amen. I'm excited to worship the Lord with you. My name is Pastor Mark, lead pastor
We are just so delighted to have you in the house of God. My wife and I will be in the lobby today to greet you. We'd love to shake your hand. And again, this is your first time here. Can I just say welcome home? Come on, everybody, just give it up for our first-time guest. We're so glad you're here. Welcome home. Amen. You're right where I believe the Lord wants you to be. So we are so glad to have you this morning. Good stuff happening Wednesday night. We've got our annual pie social coming up, 7 o'clock in the cafe. Bring a dessert, bring a pie. Just come have some fellowship. We're going to sing just to have some good times together as we enter into the Thanksgiving season. And just a whole lot that is happening around our Thanksgiving holiday, our Christmas holiday coming up. I want to say this. Again, we're just doing so many things as outreach goes. We are reopening our food pantry here at Christian Center to serve those within our congregation, and I'm very excited about that. So December 3rd, we are reopening our pantry to serve and to be a blessing to those in need within our congregation on Sundays. And so you can help with that. If you go online to christiancenter.org or go to the ER desk, there is a list of supplies that if you can buy, donate, bring them in, you can take them to the food pantry, which is right outside, I believe, door 5, right over in this area to my right. And somebody will be there next Sunday. If you want to drop it off during the week, our office is open Monday to Thursday, 9 to 4. You can drop it off anytime during those hours as well. Amen. I want to be a blessing to as many people as we possibly can. Amen. Next week, we kick off our Christmas outreach. There's so many great things. How many know God? He is moving within our congregation right now. Amen. So many good things, and we're so excited to be part of that. So just, we want you to get engaged and involved. Amen. As we move forward together. Amen. So before I get to the word, there was a group of older ladies that were driving down the road one time. They were up in their 80s, and if you're a lady in your 80s, don't be offended by this. I just lost some of my congregation right now. I know that I did. Thank you. I appreciate that. So they're driving down the road, the interstate, and they're pulled over by a police officer. Police officer walks up to the window of the driver. The lady rolls down the window of the car. She's driving. Three of her friends are in the back seat. And the officer said, he said, ma'am, I want to know, do you know why I pulled you over? She said, no, why did you pull me over? He said, you are going way too slow. He said, you're only going 35 miles an hour. And you're on the interstate. The lady said, officer, I'm just doing what the sign said. It said 35. He said, no. He said, this is interstate 35. But then he looked in the back seat, and these three ladies, their eyes were wide with terror. He said, why are these three ladies so frightened? The driver kind of chuckled. She said, well, that may be because we just got off of I-95. Who's up for a joyride this afternoon? Any ladies want to take somebody for a joyride on? Yeah. Amen. Well, I'm excited to share the Word of God with you today. I really am. I believe the Word of God has power to change your life. So I just want you right now, if you will, to turn with me to the book of Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17. Since the day of Pentecost, back in May, we have been journeying through the book of Acts to discover what a New Testament church looks like, because I want to do it the way the Bible said. We're standing out of honor of the Word of God because we know it's inspired, we know it's holy, so we respect it, we revere it. That's why we're standing. And we're trying to discover exactly what the Word of God has to say about the church. So we have gone through 16 chapters. Now we're in the 17. Actually, we didn't cover 16. I'm going to cover that probably next week. But chapter 17, I want to read just a couple of verses beginning in verse number 10. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to keep your Bible open or your phone open and your notepad or maybe your notes in your phone, whatever you take notes with. I want you to keep that open. Because there's some things I believe God wants to speak to you today that will change your life. And it's not because I'm saying it. It's because it's the Word of God. So we're going to go through a good chunk of chapter 17, but I'm just going to read one passage to get us started, and that is down in verse number 10. So Acts 17, beginning in verse number 10, if you have it, say amen. The brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night to Berea, who coming thither, they went to the synagogue of the Jews. Now, these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and they searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Many of them believed, which also of honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men not a few. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached to Paul to Berea, at Berea, they came also, and they stirred up the people. So immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go, as it were, by the sea. But Silas and Timotheus abode there still, and they that conducted Paul brought him to Athens, and receiving a commandment to Silas and Timothy for to come to him with all speed, and they departed. Your attention, I want to be focused on verse number 11. Those of Berea received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. So I have brought on the platform a small segment of my library from my office. I have a lot of books. I like to read. I like to look into what other people have said. I've got a book called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell. I've got The New Dare to Discipline by James Dobson. I've got a commentary on Daniel by John Walvoord. I've got Treasury of David by Charles Spurgeon. I've got a variety of books up here, and I've got a lot more back in my office. I like to read. I enjoy picking the mind of authors and finding what they have to say about certain subjects, and I have received a lot in my life by reading certain books. But I have to say in front of you that in spite of the good that is contained within the pages of these books, how many know there is no book that will ever change your life like the written, revealed, irrefutable word of Almighty God? Can somebody shout amen? Because these books are written by fallible men, but this book is inspired by an infallible God. In this book is the life of the Holy Spirit. It is breathed on. It is inspired. The Bible said that all scripture is given by inspiration. It is God-breathed. And so I say that because, my friend, you will never, I will never be able to spiritually succeed without the Word of God in my life. Never. And the reason is because if there's anything that's going to happen to me spiritually, how many know it is going to happen by faith? Because everything that God does, He does by faith. Amen. And the only way that faith is going to come into your life, faith only comes by the Word of God. Romans 10 tells us that. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And so, therefore, everything that God does, He does by faith. In fact, when He went to His hometown, there was no miracles that He did there simply because, the Bible said, there was unbelief. There was no faith. Even the world in which we live was created by what? Faith. Hebrews 11 says, we know that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. Those things that were not, they were created by the Word of God. And we also know, Hebrews 11 said, that without faith, it is impossible to please God. So how many know you have to have faith? Let me hear you shout amen. I said, you have to have faith. I don't care what you are taught. You've got to have faith. And the only way to get that faith is by the Word of God. And so, therefore, I want to preach to you today about the importance of the Word of God in your life. I'm going to teach you how to unpack it. I'm going to teach you how to apply it. I'm going to teach you how to use it. And I believe by the time you leave this place, your faith is going to be so high, you could take on hell with a water pistol. I believe you could take on any demon of hell. You could go out into the world so confident and full of faith because you are packed full of the Word of God. And I'm going to tell you that none of you are going to live the rest of your life in defeat. You're going to live from victory to victory, mountain to mountain, because you have the revealed Word of God in your life. And I just declare unto your faith is going to go somewhere that it's never been. How many receive that in Jesus' name? Amen. It's going to happen. I believe that with all of my heart. And so we arrive at the 17th chapter of the book of Acts. As we arrive, we find a group of people that are in this chapter that the Bible says in our text in verse 11 that they receive the word with all readiness of mind and they search the scriptures daily. The Bible gives them high praise because they've got this desire to receive and not only receive but also research and study the word of God on their own. And so therefore, I'm going to give you three things today. Number one, I'm going to tell you about the personal rejection of the word. Number two, I'm going to tell you about the personal receptivity of the word. And number three, I'm going to tell you about the personal response to the word. And you're going to leave this place with a greater understanding of how to apply the word of God into your life. So, as we go into this chapter, look in verse number one, you find Paul and Silas. They have now passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, and they have come to Thessalonica. Last week, we talked about their desire to preach the word in Asia. The Holy Ghost redirected them, and now they come to Thessalonica. Now, as he comes, the Bible said he comes to the synagogue, and as his manner was, he went in for three Sabbath days, and he reasoned with the Jews in Thessalonica. In other words, Paul had a habit. When it was the Sabbath day, he went to church. How many believe that's a good habit? Amen. On the Lord's day, it's good to be in the house of God. You're here, and I appreciate that. And so Paul goes in to the synagogue, and he reasons with the Jews. Now, the Greek word reason is the same as our English word dialogue. So what Paul is doing, he's going into the synagogue, and he's sitting down with the Jews, and he's having a conversation. He's having a dialogue with them. And the dialogue is based on the scriptures, the Old Testament prophecies. And he's talking about the Old Testament prophecies about the Messiah. And, of course, Paul proves to them out of the scriptures that Jesus is the Messiah. Now, the result of that, bring that scripture back up, if you will, verse number three. He said that he proved to them that Christ had to suffer and rise again. And the result of that in verse 4, some of them believed. Some of them received it, but there was in verse 5, Jews which believed not. And they moved with envy, and they took certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and they set the city on an uproar. In other words, these that did not believe went and got some guys that were rabble rousers and created conflict, and they created this big uproar in the city. Now, that leads me to the first point that I want to share with you this morning, and that is this: the personal rejection to the Word of God. How many know there are some people that have not received the Word of God? How many know that? But what's amazing to me that in this passage, that these people that did not receive the Word, but rather rejected the Word, they were not tax collectors, they were not publicans, they were not prostitutes, they were not alcoholics, they were religious people. They were Jews, they were in church, they were in the synagogue. It was their habit to be in the synagogue. But the moment that Paul the Apostle cracked the scripture and began to share with them truth that went against their tradition, immediately they got angry, they got envious, and they got so mad that they got this group of men to create this big uproar in the city, and they made a big scene, and I'm just going to challenge you to read it when you go home, but they made this big scene bringing the house of Jason out, and they made a huge conflict all because they did not want to accept a truth that went against their tradition. Let me tell you something. You know who your biggest enemy is going to be? Your biggest enemy is not going to be the alcoholic, and it's not going to be the drug addict, but it's going to be a religious person that is so locked into their tradition that they wouldn't know the truth if it slapped them upside the face. There are people that literally come to church every week that are so locked into what a man told them is a traditional way of living that they can look into the Word of God and they will not receive the truth of the Word of Almighty God. Let me tell you something. I know that. I've been in church. My wife and I have been in church pretty much all of our life. I have seen so much. I have seen churches split. I have seen churches just fight. I have seen voices raised. I have seen ugly stuff happen in the house of God. But you know what? I have never seen a church split by an alcoholic. I have never seen a church split by a drug addict. But you know what I have seen? I have seen a church split by religious people. I have seen churches split by people that are so religious that they will not let go of their man-made traditions, and they, like these people, will stir up an uproar within the house of God. And I've seen people that have gathered their little crew, and they bring that little crew together, and they spread gossip, and they spread discord, and they spread rumors, and they talk about everybody else in the church, and they take their little 17 or 18 people, and they go off, and they start their own thing as if they are more spiritual and more holy, and almost every single time what they do fails because it was not based on truth. It was based on tradition, and it was based out of a bad, envious spirit. Let me tell you something, church. Amen. I know what this is all about. I've been that guy. I've been a guy that has been locked into man-made tradition, but thank God, tradition doesn't set you free. But how many believe when Jesus said, I'm going to give you the truth, and the truth is going to set you free? That's what freedom is all about. Somebody shout amen. I mean, you've seen these people. I mean, they are miserable. And I got a lot to say, so I can't stay here long. But how many know a religious spirit will make you miserable? How many know what I'm talking about? I mean, they come into church. They're miserable. They're unhappy. They're bitter. And they spread that bitterness to everybody around them. Listen, when you receive the Word of God, Jesus said, these things I've spoken to you. Why? That my joy, everybody shout the word joy, my joy should remain in you. Amen. Peter said, you've not seen these things. He said, but he said, you have believed. And he said, because of that, he said, you are filled with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Listen to me, church. How many believe the house of God ought to be a place of joy? Let me hear you shout amen. People should not walk in and be greeted by a sourpuss, amen, man or woman that's been in church for 42 years, just long enough for them to become so bitter. They ought to be greeted by people that are so full of the Holy Ghost, so big of a smile on their face, where the worship is enlightening and uplifting. You ought to leave this place more happy and joyful, amen, than any place you go in the world. Do you believe it? Shout amen. Amen. Glory to God. But these people were so locked into their tradition, they could not receive the word. And so here's my challenge to you. I don't really know what your tradition is. I know what my tradition was. Amen. I know what I lived because what man told me that I had to do and how I had to dress and what I had to wear and what I could do and what I couldn't do. And really none of it had grounding within the Word of God. It was a traditional man-made mindset. I know what that is, and I don't know what it is for you. But here's my challenge. How about you throw all of the man-made traditions out the door and let this be the first day that you say, Lord, I'm going to take your word as it says, and I'm not going to let man tell me. I'm going to let you tell me what is right and what is wrong. And how many believe you're going to, shackles of tradition are going to bust off, and you're going to be free in the name of Jesus. Do you believe it? Shout amen. Amen. Glory to God. So you've got to understand, sometimes you cannot read the Word of God through a traditional mindset, through a mindset that you've been raised in, because man can twist the Word of God to say whatever he or she wants it to say. I've seen that happen. I mean, I've seen people that have twisted the Word of God to tell you what kind of shoes you can and cannot wear. That's the truth. And so you've got to open your heart and your mind to the Word of God, not based on what man has told you in your upbringing, but based on, and this is what leads me to number two, based on what the Bereans were. Look in verse number 11. You are going to receive it as those with readiness of mind, and you will search the scriptures daily whether those things were so. That is number two that I want to share with you, the personal receptivity to the Word of God. How many want to receive the Word of God? Let me hear you shout amen. Paul shows up, and these Bereans are so ready to hear what he has to say. And they are so ready that they even go home after he gets done preaching, and they study the Word of God for themselves. Now, let me just stop. I want to give a compliment to this church. You guys are, it is good, easy to preach here. And I mean that. Because there is a receptivity that you have to the Word of God. And I can tell, I can feel that. When you shout amen, that's like saying, sick him to a hound dog. I mean, you pull on the Word when somebody is, and I appreciate that. But it's not that way everywhere you go. But I want our church to be a church where we have just this hunger and this desire to receive the Word of God. Now, let me illustrate it like this. Pastor Lee, come here. Jeremy, come here. Let me illustrate it like this. So, Pastor Lee's got a football. Jeremy, I want you to stand right over there. I'm going to psych you up, man. You got it going on. Turn around. I'm going to just, come on. You got this going on, dude. How many believe Jeremy can catch this football? He needs more than that. I said, how many believe Jeremy can receive this football? How many believe Pastor Lee can throw this football? I think they like Jeremy better than you. Yeah. Are you ready? I want to see your best Sam Hartman. Well, no, don't do that. All right, you ready? All right, let's go. Wait. Come here. Hold this for me. Hold that one for me. Hold that one for me. Hold this one for me. Come on, hold this one for me. Hold this one for me. Oh, let's see. Is that good? Okay, now get over there. Okay. All right, here we go. Come on, Jeremy, you want to catch this football? I'm ready. Throw it. You didn't catch the ball. What is wrong with you? I'm not even going to go there. I say, who do you play for? But I'm not even, I have really tried to refrain on the Notre Dame jokes here recently. Am I doing good? I'm doing better. Doing better. Okay. How many believe he had the capability of receiving, but he could not receive because he had too much he was carrying? Come on, give Jeremy and Lee a good hand. Just put those books right there. Thank you. You see, here's the problem. You have the capability to receive the Word of God. But the problem is, when you come into church, you're carrying the worry about your job. You're carrying the worry about your marriage. You're carrying about the stress of your son being on drugs. You're worried about how you're going to pay your bills. And you come into the house of God, and you're carrying all this stuff. And when the Word of God goes forth, you're saying, why can't I get anything? I tell you why you can't get anything. Because you've got to drop what you are carrying, and you've got to open up your heart, and you've got to say, Lord, I don't care what's going on in my life right now. I don't care what my son does. I don't care what's going on out in the world right now. I know this is the book that's going to change my life, and I am receiving your word, and I am dropping everything because this is the inspired word of Almighty God. How many believe it? Shout amen. You've got to come. Now that leads me to the second thing. You've got to come with a ready mind. You've got to prepare your mind. You've got to get up early enough where you're not driving to church and cramming a peanut butter and jelly down your 7-year-old's throat. Or your husband's throat, either one. Get up quiet your mind. Did I just hit somebody there? I feel that. Quiet your mind and begin to open your heart so when you walk in that back door, you are ready to receive, thus saith the Lord, and you are ready for the Holy Ghost to take God's word and do something in your life. How many can get ready? Come on, somebody. Look at your neighbor, say, get ready. Come on, get ready. Listen, that's why we have worship. I said, that's why we have worship. You ought to get here in time for worship. Because worship is a preparation of your heart for the word of God. When you look in the Bible, the Levites, 1 Chronicles 16, God appointed the Levites as ministers before the ark of the Lord. They were walking in front of the presence of God. And so this worship team is here to walk in front and issue in or usher in the presence of Almighty God. So listen, get up. Get here on time. Get ready to worship the Lord. Engage in worship. Lift your hands. Sing these songs because the Spirit of God will cultivate your heart, cultivate your mind so that you are ready to receive the word of Almighty God. How many believe that? Shout amen. So they came in, they received, and they were ready for the word. They were hot. Now, when you look at that word readiness, literally, it means zeal, spirit, eagerness. Prothumia is the name of, is the Greek word. There was an eagerness they had to come into the house of God, an eagerness they had to receive the word of God. Let me ask a question. How many of you eat differently when you're hungry than when you're not hungry and you just sit at the table because everybody else is eating? How many eat differently? Show of hands. Of course you do. You're hungry and everybody knows that you're hungry because when they try to talk to you, your mouth is always full. And you are shoveling it in. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about. Let's be real. I do the same. I was hungry yesterday. We were raking leaves, and I was ready for Chipotle. It was good. But when you're hungry, people know that you're hungry. And they leave you alone because you're hungry. Never engage a hungry person in conversation. That's the kind of eagerness that people should have about the Word of God when they come into the house of God. I'm hungry. I'm not distracted by what's going on. I don't care who's sitting behind me. I don't care what he's wearing. It doesn't matter that his cologne stinks. I am hungry for the word. Oh, come on, somebody shout hungry. I want a group of people that say, Lord, I know that this can change my life, and my appetite is ready to receive what you have to say. Amen. They were ready. And again, I don't want to get off, but this is what's happening in America, though. There is a famine of the Word of God. And I tell you why. Because churches are more interested on, you know, preaching series, you know, summer at the movies and finding life principles from the movie of Barbie. Barbie and Ken. Let's see what the Word of God. Let me tell you something. I'll tell you what the Word of God has to say about Barbie and Ken. They're unreal. They're not real. They're fake. But we've got churches that are preaching sermon series about the Addams Family and Barbie and all this other stuff. How about we cut the junk and get back to the Word of God and just say, Lord, I want the pure, undefiled truth of your word. Don't spin it in a relevant way. Let me know what it says so that I can live a successful life. Come on, somebody. Are you with me? Let me just hear you shout amen. This is what's happening. And I just want to tell you that as your pastor, as your leader, I just want to preach this book to you in the best way that I possibly can, send you home with some principles that I believe you can take for 7 days in the next week and apply your life to those principles, and your life can go and be changed in Jesus' name. Amen. So there was a receptivity, there was a readiness, but then the third thing about them is that they researched the word on their own. The Bible said they studied these things to see whether or not they were so. Now think about it. They're listening to the Apostle Paul. He's the greatest apostle that ever lived. 13 out of 27 New Testament books were written by Paul. But yet these people did not take what Paul had to say for granted. They went home and they read it for themselves. Church, let me tell you, if the only time you open the Bible is on Sunday, you're in bad shape. I'm just telling you, you're in bad shape. Because I am not here to give you your weekly meal. I am here to stimulate you to wake up tomorrow and open up the Word of God and see that with what I preached was accurate according to the Word, and so that you can grow on your own. Amen. Listen, I guarantee, I'll wait on that. I better not say that. Now you threw me off, man. We want to try to make this easy for you. Pull up the screenshot of the app. We are really trying to give you, every sermon is on the app. Every sermon is on the CCC app. You can do it Google Play, Apple App Store. And what we want to do, every sermon is there. And you can simply click on that. And when you go there, not only can you see the sermon, but every scripture that I share is also under the notes section. And you can go back and you can review the notes, and then you can take notes. All the principles are there so that you can review this throughout the week. Because when I get up here and holler at you for 45 minutes, you're not going to remember everything that I say, because I talk way too fast. Nobody wants to say amen to that. I know, I talk way too, I get it. I really do, I understand. I'm really trying to slow down and I'm trying to be more intentional. But I do that, I want you to take what I say on Sunday, and I want you to go home, and I want you to research it for yourself and study the Word of God on your own. Can I get a witness on somebody? Shout amen. Now, so what does that mean? That means, number one, you got to do it consistently. You've got to do it consistently. Psalm 1. The psalmist said, he said, in his law doth he meditate day and night. Now, I'm just guessing here. This is a total guess. I mean, if I'm off, then you can correct me afterwards. I'm guessing that you eat more than 3 meals a week. Am I right? You eat 3 meals a day. Plus, so if we do that physically, how many believe spiritually you ought to read your Bible more than 3 times a week? It ought to be every single day. Everybody shout the word daily. Daily you ought to meditate in the Word of God. I read the Bible just about every day at the exact same time. Just about every day I read it at the same time. If it's not the same time, I get to it. But I have a time that I have designated on my calendar that I am reading the Word of God every day. Before I go to bed at night, I am reading a proverb before I go to bed and getting the Word in my mind. You see, my friend, it is a daily thing. And if you're not reading the Word of God daily, how about we start today? Let me hear you shout amen. Amen. Now, not only consistently, but you also need to read it comprehensively. Now, what that means is there are some people, they only read the New Testament. They never read the Old Testament. You are missing out on some of the best stories that you will ever hear. I mean it. There's some wild things that God did in the Old Testament. There's some people, they never study prophecy because they're scared of it. And then there's some people, that's all they study is prophecy because they like the sensationalism of it. The point is, you need to read the entirety of the Word of God, because how many believe this all fits together? Let me hear you shout, amen. So consistently, comprehensively, and thirdly, you need to read it consciously. Now, that doesn't mean that you're in a coma. I'm talking about pay attention when you read. How many know sometimes your mind wanders? Come on, how many can be honest? When you're reading the Bible, your mind wanders. It's a funny story. One time, there was a lady, her son was in the other room, and he was being really quiet, so she didn't know what was going on. So she called out. She said, hey! She said, Bobby, what are you doing? Bobby hollered back to his mom. He said, I'm watching Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. So she got a little concerned. She said, how is he watching Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead? She walked in. He had his Bible open. Nothing else. He had his Bible open and was reading his Bible. And at that point, she realized he was so into the Bible, he wasn't just reading about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. He was literally watching. In his mind, he was watching Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. When you read the Word of God, how many believe your mind should be all in? Let me hear you shout, amen. Pay attention. Set everything else aside. Close the door. Shut all the distractions out. And get into the Word of God consistently, comprehensively, consciously. And number four, can I just add this with a commentary? And you can choose whatever commentary you want, but I like to read trusted men what they have to say about the Word of God. And if you will do a word study, and you will understand, and you don't have to know Greek to do this, but look up in commentaries the meaning of words, it's going to give you an entirely different meaning. Church, what I'm telling you, it is your responsibility to read the Word of God and to apply. I can't do it for you. I can't live your life. But how many believe God can give you the power to live everything and receive everything that is in this book, and your life is going to skyrocket to a spiritual level that it has never been? Do you believe that? Shout amen. It's the patterns of life that produce the desire of your life. You've got to set this as a pattern. So these people were receptive. They were ready. But I want to share with you number three. I want you to look at the response to the Word of God. Paul is the preacher here. In another place, Paul writes this in Ephesians 6. He says in verse 17, he said, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now, how many are glad to be saved? Let me hear you shout amen. Thank God for salvation. But I love how Paul puts these two things in the same verse, back to back. Helmet of salvation, sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now listen, what I'm about to tell you, I believe will revolutionize your life if you will apply this to your life. You know the dissertation that Paul has about the armor in Ephesians 6. All of the pieces of armor up to this point are defensive pieces of armor. Look at it, Ephesians 6. He said, your loins, they're girt about with truth. You've got the breastplate of righteousness. Your feet, they're covered with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The shield of faith, the helmet of salvation. All of that is defensive in nature. But you see, you can be defended and you can be protected, but you will never, listen to me, you will never defeat the enemy until you go on the offensive with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. You can receive everything that I've said, but until you begin to make personal application to what the Word of God has to say in your life, you will never defeat the enemy. Now, let me ask you, how many believe you can, by the grace of God, defeat the devil? Let me hear you shout, amen. You know why? Because he's already been defeated. All you've got to do is take the Word and apply what's been said, and he has no power in your life. None. But this is the only offensive piece of armor there is. And so Paul is saying, now, when we talk about sword automatically we think of those medieval swords, you know, the big long 3 to 4 foot swords that are heavy, and that's basically what many of them were. They were double-edged, and they had a metal knob at the base of the hilt. They were 3 to 4 feet in length. But the sword that Paul is talking about is a Roman sword. And the Romans would use a sword only about 18 inches in length. It was, longer sword was called the Rhamphia, but the smaller sword was called the Machaira. And this is a sword, in fact, we get our Latin term gladius, from which we get our word gladiator. This was a sword whereby the Roman soldier would be able to go like this. He would be able to puncture. He would be able to slash. You see, the bigger swords were used after the victory. They would cut the head off like David did with Goliath. But these are small swords. And that means they could get into the pieces, amen, of the armor. And they would be able to get a puncture into the organs of that individual. And they were able to kill that individual. So Paul is saying the word of God is not like this big slashing sword. And let me say, how many have used the word of God? No, I shouldn't say it. How many have seen people use the word of God to try to destroy somebody else? We're not talking about slashing. We're talking about taking the word and using it against the enemy and getting to the very heart of the enemy. And the interesting thing is, as Paul talks about this, there's two different Greek words for the word of God. The one word is logos. Everybody say the word logos. Logos is the written word. It is what you hold in your hand. But the other Greek word is rhema. Everybody say the word rhema. Rhema is the spoken word. And so when Paul said that the sword of the Spirit is the word of God, if you look at that, he's not using the word logos. Because many times, if you're old like me, how many remember in church, your youth pastor used to say, hey, let's have a sword drill. How many remember sword drills? Nobody does? Okay, good. You know, we all get our Bibles out. The written word is not what Paul's talking about. He said, if you're going to use the sword of the Spirit, it is going to be the rhema word. It is going to be the spoken word. Because you see, you can carry your Bible around all day long, and the devil can still try to attack you, and you will not be able to defend yourself. But the moment that you come and you speak the word of God, the devil has to flee like a stupid puppy with his tail between his legs, because he cannot stand against the spoken word of Almighty God. Do you believe it? Shout amen. Amen. Paul said this. Amen. He said, the word, Romans 10, the word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth. That is the word of faith. Listen, church, what I'm challenging you to do is go home and read the word, but then as you go through your day, start speaking the word over your life. And when you speak the word over your life, sickness has to go, depression has to flee, amen, the devil has to leave you alone, and you are walking through life singing the song of victory. Why? Because you've got the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, in your mouth. Do you believe it? Shout amen. Look at somebody, say, just say it. Just say it. Look at what Job said. Check this out. He said, Job, are you understand what I'm saying today? Job said this. He said, you will decree a thing. Oh man, if you miss anything, don't miss this verse. He said, you will decree a thing, and it will be established unto you, and the light will shine upon your ways. Bring this up. Decree. A decree is an official order given by a person with power or by a government, having the force of law. Keep that up there. Look at that definition. Job said, if you decree a thing, what is a decree? It is an order given by a person with power or by a government. So if I decree the word of God, how many know this is an order that has been given by the creator of the universe? And the power of Almighty God backs everything that I say. And when I say it, I am speaking the... Oh, my God, somebody needs to hear what I'm about to say. You need to stop allowing the devil to fill your head with lies and start speaking the decrees of the word of God, because it is a divine government in whom all the power of the universe exists. And when you speak the word of God, you are changing the universe, because the word of God has power. Do you believe it? Shout amen. Start speaking to your sickness. Start speaking amen to that spiritual oppression. Start speaking to your depression. Start speaking to your anxiety. Start speaking to the difficult mountain in front of you, and say to that mountain, be thou removed. And Jesus said, you are going to have anything you say. Somebody needs to receive it and shout hallelujah. That is what the sword of the Spirit is. It is the rhema word. And I believe that starting today, listen, Jesus even looked at the devil. He's the Son of God, but Jesus looked at the devil when the devil came, and he said, no, it is written. I said, it is written. I said, it is written. If there's anything in your life right now that does not match the word of God, you need to look at that thing and say, it is written. No, the word of God does not say that I have to be depressed. No, the word of God does not say that I have to be sick. No, the word of God does not say that my family has to fall apart. No, it is written. Devil, you can say and do what you want to do. My God, I'm about to shout. You can do and say what you want to do, but it is written. This is what God said. I choose what God said. I don't choose CNN. I don't choose Fox News. I don't choose my co-worker's word. I don't choose what anybody else says. I choose what God says. And when you speak what God says, how many believe it changes your life? Do you believe it? Shout amen. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, get on your feet. And I want you right now to give God just a shout of praise for the word that is in your mouth and the word that is in your heart and the word that is going to change your life and the word that is going to heal your body and the word that is going to heal your mind and the word that is going to heal your home and the word that is going to give you a financial breakthrough and the word that is going to elevate you to a place you have never been. Somebody shout hallelujah. Give God a hand clap of praise in this house. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Lift up your hands with me right now. Oh, Jesus, I receive your word. Say that, I receive your word. Come on, say it, I receive your word. I receive your word. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just thank him right now. I feel faith rising in this place right now. I feel faith coming up. Faith is coming up. Faith is rising. Oh, my God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The altar is open. Come on, if you have faith, amen, if you have faith, get out of your seat. Make your way down to this altar. Amen, I want you to lift up your hands and begin to worship God for the answer. Begin to worship God for the answer. Amen, I don't want my God, stop praying about it and start thanking God for it. Begin to worship God for the answer right now. Begin to, yes, 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 yes. There's faith coming up in this house. Take the step of faith. Get out of your seat and say, no more. No more. No more. Oh, I'm speaking the word. No more. I'm not going to accept anymore. I'm speaking the word of God. Oh, yes, 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 Lord. Glory to God. There's freedom, more people that need to come. There's quit complaining about it.
We sing.
Quit complaining about it.
This is God in His holy place.
Start claiming it right now.
This is God clothed in love and strength. Sing out, lift your voice and cry out. Awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God.
Get out here and receive it. Yes, Lord.
With us in the wilderness, faithful to provide every breath and every step. We see this is God in His holy place. This is God clothed in love and strength.
Sing it out!
Sing out, lift your voice and cry out. Awesome our strong God, mighty is our God. Sing out, lift your voice and shout out. Awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God. There is no, there is no greater. No, there is none stronger than our God. There is no higher. No, there is no greater. No, there is none stronger than our God.
Right now. Woo! Come on, call out to him. Call out to him.
There is none greater. There is no one stronger. None greater. No one stronger. No one greater. No one stronger.
Somebody needs a family breakthrough.
No higher,
lift up your hand.
No,
I want you to decree in Jesus' name, my household will be saved. My household will be saved. My children will be saved. My children will be saved. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Church, sing it. Let me hear you shout amen. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Spirit of the Lord is in this room right now. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Just worship Him for a moment. Come on, just worship Him for a moment. Just worship Him. Yes, Lord, You're worthy. Yes, Lord, You're worthy. Yes, Lord, You're worthy. Jesus, we magnify. Oh, we praise Your name. We praise Your name. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Jesus, I praise Your name. Oh, thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. How many believe God touched you today? Let me hear you just right now. Come on. Wave your hand. Just wave your hand. How many believe God touched you today? Let the Word of God dwell in you richly. Every single day. You're going to have the best week of your life. Amen. Praise God. You're going to have the best week of your life. And I believe the Lord is just going to take you from glory to glory. And I believe every Sunday when we gather together, every Wednesday when we gather together, it's going to get better and better and better for the glory of God. And more of the presence of God will fill this place because we're going somewhere. And by the grace of God, we're going to see South Bend saved in Jesus' name. Somebody shout hallelujah. Glory to God. So I pray, take what I've said today. Take it home. Dissect it. Digest it. Tell somebody about it. Amen. Wednesday night, join us for our Pi Social. But next Sunday, be here ready to receive the word. And let's see God do something great. Amen. For a first-time guest, stop by the cafe today. If you need additional prayer, altar workers are going to be here. Lift your hand with me right now. Father, thank You for Your word today. Holy Spirit, just do something special. I pray in our lives this week. Lord, let our lives be changed because of Your word today. And Lord, we love You, we honor You, we praise You. And Father, till we gather again, we believe we're going to come back shouting praise unto You, and You're going to receive all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody shout amen. Give God one more hand clap of praise in this place right now. Turn around, shake five people's hand, and greet them in the name of the Lord today. Amen. God bless you as you go in Jesus. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us for the Christian Center live stream. We hope you enjoyed service today. And if you'd like to learn more about us, please download our app available on the Google Play Store or the Apple App Store. Visit our website at www.christiancenter.org or feel free to call us at 574-291-3292. And, of course, we'd love to welcome you in person. Our church is located at 530 East Ireland Road in South Bend, and our service times are every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. and every Wednesday at 7 p.m. If you need to contact us throughout the week, our office hours are Monday through Thursday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Thanks again for joining us for the Christian Center live stream, Christian Center Church, where we are connecting to God and connecting to each other.